John the Baptist was a man who dressed with rough clothing, ate a rough diet, and spoke with rough words. And yet, at the heart of everything he did was a message of love. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you. Hi, my name is Ed Horstmann, and welcome to the online service of worship from Round Hill Community Church in Greenwich, Connecticut. We are delighted that you have joined us for this online experience of worship, and we look forward to staying connected with you in this way. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Those are the words I want to use to start these words of welcome. Thank you to all of you who have been participants in this online service, some of you for more than 2.5 years. Some of you may be watching this service for the very first time, but thank you to all of you. We are not worshiping together in the same room in person, but that doesn't mean that we are disconnected. We share the same message of faith and hope and love, and thank God we can stay connected through this online experience of worship, which is made possible because you're watching it and you are supporting it. So thank you for all of that support and participation now for over 2.5 years. On September 11th, we are going to experience Celebration Sunday at Round Hill Community Church. This will also mark the beginning of many of our spiritual faith formation programs. So we're looking forward to celebrating everything that we can these days. And also, we encourage you to visit our website on a regular basis, roundhillcommunitychurch.org. There you will see updates about faith formation programs that will be taking place online and in person. Once again, my gratitude to all of you. And together with people of faith and hope and love all across the world, worshiping in person and online, let us worship God. Let us pray. O God, our disturber, whose speech is pregnant with power and whose word will be fulfilled, may we know ourselves unsatisfied with all that distorts your truth and make our hearts attentive to your liberating voice in Jesus Christ. Amen. And let us pray as Jesus taught his disciples to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
A fisherman on a boat, a storm started when they were fishing. They got scared. Jesus took a nap before this, and they went to wake up Jesus, and then Jesus stopped the storm.
So Henry, you talked about the story of the storm. Now tell us, what does that mean to you? What does it make you feel like knowing that when you have stormy times in your life, maybe you can talk to Jesus also?
To fix them.
To fix them?
Yeah.
Great. And that, how does that make you feel knowing Jesus is there for you?
Good.
Good. And how can you give any good advice to somebody else who doesn't know about this story and might be worried about things that are happening in their lives?
Jesus is there for you.
Jesus is always there for you. Awesome. All right, start by telling us who you are.
Hello, my name is Ashley.
Ashley, that's a beautiful name. Ashley, tell us all about what you did at VBS this week. What was your favorite part?
Playing.
Playing? Did you learn any fun stories or do any fun crafts that you liked?
Yeah.
Which craft did you enjoy?
Water bottle one.
The water bottles that we turned into waves. And do you remember why we were talking about waves?
No.
You don't? Remember we said about making waves and how that's being a force for good? We want to make waves in the world?
Yeah.
Yeah? How do you think you might be able to make waves, good waves in the world?
Going water.
Going where?
Water.
Oh, okay. That sounds great.
Before Jesus began his ministry, he was preceded by a man named John the Baptist. Now, John the Baptist had a following of his own. He probably had disciples of his own, but the point of his ministry was not to draw attention to himself. It was to cast the spotlight of attention on Jesus and the new things, the good things that God was going to do in the world through him. So in our scripture lesson for this morning, we have a chance to learn a little bit about John the Baptist and to hear the words that he used to describe Jesus of Nazareth. A reading from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. In those days, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judea, proclaiming, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is the one of whom the prophet Isaiah spoke when he said, "The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." Now John wore clothing of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Then the people of Jerusalem and all Judea were going out to him, and all the region along the Jordan, and they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many Pharisees and Sadducees coming for baptism, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruit worthy of repentance. Do not presume to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our ancestor.' For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now, the axe is lying at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I'm not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and will gather his wheat into the granary. But the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." In the name of God, the Creator, the Christ, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Frederick Buechner was an extraordinary writer and prolific. I think over the course of his lifetime, he created almost 40 books. He was hard to categorize. When he was in his 20s, he wrote a book of fiction that was very popular. But then he was ordained as a Christian minister. He went off to serve a private school in the Northeast as its chaplain and continued to do his writing and eventually decided to become a full-time writer. He never served a church as its pastor. And yet, through his writings over the years, he served many churches. Probably no American author has been quoted more frequently from the pulpit than Frederick Buechner. His books were often memoirs in which he explored the ways in which God moves in our personal lives through our histories. And then many of his other books were reflections on biblical and religious themes. Frederick Buechner died on August the 15th. And actually, he crossed paths with Round Hill Community Church some years ago because he came to Round Hill Community Church and delivered a lecture. One of my favorite books of his is called Peculiar Treasures, a Biblical Who's Who, in which he wrote very brief bio sketches of many biblical characters. And this is the one that he wrote for John the Baptist. John the Baptist didn't fool around. He lived in the wilderness around the Dead Sea. He subsisted on a starvation diet, and so did his disciples. He wore clothes that even the rummage sale people wouldn't have handled. When he preached, it was fire and brimstone every time. Your only hope, he said, was to clean up your life as if your life depended on it, which it did, and get baptized in a hurry as a sign that you had. Some people thought he was the prophet Elijah come back from the grave. And some others thought he was the Messiah, but John would have none of either. I'm the one yelling himself blue in the face in the wilderness, he said, quoting the prophet Isaiah. I'm the one trying to knock some sense into your heads. That's Frederick Buechner's take on John the Baptist. It's not always easy to find the fun in faith, but it's funny that stories about John the Baptist are often told in the Christian tradition in the weeks right before Christmas. Every year, just when we might start to be feeling in the spirit of the season, humming our favorite carols, baking our favorite baked goods, decorating our homes and sanctuaries, churches start to tell the story of this rough, sharp-tongued man who announced the arrival of Jesus, but not exactly in ways that were easy on the ears. Repent, he said. That's one of those church words like sin. You hear it once, feels like you hear it 10 times. When people traveled all the way from Jerusalem and the region around Jerusalem to listen to John the Baptist, to be baptized by them, some of them he referred to as a brood of vipers. And he warned that the coming of Jesus would usher in an extraordinarily difficult time of self-appraisal. Even now, he said, the axe is being laid to the root of the trees. Don't those words seem perfectly suited to the holiday season? Can't you just hear behind them, it's beginning to sound a lot like Christmas? With promoters like John the Baptist, it's amazing that Christianity ever got out of the gate. Whoever created the stories that we have about Jesus must have thought that John the Baptist was an incredibly important figure, because we have four gospel portraits of Jesus. They go by the names Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. In those stories, interestingly enough, there are birth stories of Jesus only in two of them. That wonderful story of the Magi who visit the infant Jesus, that's only in the Gospel of Matthew. The shepherds who hear the angels one night and go to visit the infant Jesus and his family, that's only in the gospel according to Luke. But all four gospel portraits of Jesus contain stories of John the Baptist. He was a rooster, like that rooster, the rooster I can sometimes hear on Round Hill early in the morning, announcing the dawning of a new day. He was a human hinge, providing a doorway to swing open, ushering in a new age. As a person who found himself at the intersection of an extraordinary crossroads in history, John was, in a sense, both new school and old school. He was new school in the sense that he was curious about the things that Jesus was going to reveal about God in the world, how God, in a sense, was going to introduce a newness and a vibrancy into the world through Jesus. On the other hand, John the Baptist was about as old school as they come. In matters of speech and clothing and place of employment, he was not a trendsetter. He wore camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and that may not mean much to us, but to those who saw him, who heard about him, that clothing would have signaled a similarity with another great prophet who had lived many hundreds of years before John the Baptist by the name of Elijah. Now, Elijah was one of the great prophetic figures of Israel's history, someone who dared to expose the abuse of power in a king and a queen. He was fearless, mysterious, confrontational, and like Elijah, John spoke with rough words that would have reminded his listeners of that great prophetic tradition, that willingness to speak truth to power, to go toe-to-toe with those who abuse it. As religious and political leaders will sometimes choose a special location to deliver their message or introduce a platform, John's choice of venue to deliver his message was important. He could have planted himself in the city of Jerusalem on a street corner with a sandwich board saying, "Repent," but he didn't do that. Instead, he made people get out of their comfort zones. He made them travel to the backcountry, to the wilderness of Judea, off the grid. His baptismal font wasn't a little bowl that we use in the church. It was the River Jordan. His pulpit was probably a boulder. His sanctuary didn't have a roof. It only had the vault of the heavens above him. So Christianity, like Judaism and Islam, was born in the wilderness. And John, in a sense, was its midwife. By making himself a wilderness destination, John would have stirred up powerful memories in those who came out to listen and to be baptized and to reset their priorities. After all, the people of Israel wandered for 40 years in the wilderness on their way to the promised land. And that great prophet Elijah, he once spent 40 days in the wilderness, also reprioritizing his life. For John and those who came out to be part of the movement that he initiated, the wilderness would have had resonances of freedom, new beginnings, and resilience. Belden Lane is an American theologian who has thought long and hard about how place shapes faith and spirituality. And in one of his books, he talks a great deal about his great personal fondness for the desert and the wilderness. And so this is what he says: "What life there is in the desert is often as bizarre and deadly as the fierce terrain on which it persists. Black and yellow scorpions, bearded vultures, and leopards of the Judean desert can still be found in the Negev. The caper bush takes root by eating its way into the side of a cliff, secreting a rock-dissolving acid from its root hairs. The acacia tree is one of the few trees able to survive in the desert, only because it can sink its roots some 100 feet into the soil. There is an eerie, grotesque quality to the tenacity of desert life." Now, could it be that John the Baptist was bringing people out into the wilderness, not only for them to experience the resonance of freedom and new beginnings, but also because he wanted to describe faith, for them to experience faith, as something tenacious, something that requires resilience, stick-to-itiveness. Who is John the Baptist for us today? Do we see or hear anyone like him? Who's the one who calls with special urgency, who occupies that position of being a human hinge between who helps a door to swing open from one age to another? Is there anyone like this? Anyone who comes to mind? One person who comes to mind for me is Greta Thunberg. Greta is 19 years old. She's from Sweden. Like John the Baptist, Greta seems drawn to wild places. Several years ago, she came to the United States in order to address those who gathered for the United Nations Climate Summit. But she didn't use an airplane to get here. She sailed with a small crew across the Atlantic Ocean. Now, that's clearly someone who's comfortable in some wild places. Like John the Baptist, the words that she used to deliver her message were clear, probing, unsettling. This is what she says, or what she said several years ago. I have many dreams, but this is not the time and place for dreams. This is the time to wake up. This is the moment in history when we need to be wide awake. And yes, we need dreams. We cannot live without dreams. But there's a time and place for everything, and dreams cannot stand in the way of telling it like it is. I know you are desperate for hope and solutions, she said to those who were gathered at the summit, but the biggest source of hope and the easiest solution is right in front of you, and it has been all along, and it is us. And those were her extraordinary words spoken to the United Nations Climate Summit. And I would say that John the Baptist and Greta Thunberg have this in common, an uncompromising demand for change in behavior of those who stand at these threshold moments in the world, and we certainly stand at a threshold moment ourselves. One word that I associate with John the Baptist and Greta Thunberg is the word repentance, that word that you say it once, sounds like you've heard it 10 times. For many, this word, I think, has unfortunately come to be associated with judgment and scolding. You know, a harsh word of condemnation spoken by one person who seems to feel morally superior to another. But the word repentance comes from a beautiful Greek word, metanoia, that means to turn. And I think that that meaning and that word are expressed beautifully in an old Shaker hymn called, "'Tis a gift to be simple, 'tis a gift to be free. 'Tis the gift to come down where we ought to be. And when we find ourselves in the place just right, 'twill be in the valley of love and delight. When true simplicity is gained, to bow and to bend, we shan't be ashamed. To turn, turn will be our delight. Till by turning, turning, we come round right." So here's this ancient word, repentance, which means turning, that's lifted up in this old Shaker hymn as an experience of delight. So today we might translate it as reorientation or repositioning. But metanoia, whatever we want to call it, is always a movement away from something that is life diminishing, something that demeans life or other people, in order to face in a new direction where we are now engaged in behaviors and attitudes that are life enhancing. That turning involves fresh challenges. Changes in behavior are never easy, but it also presents us with new opportunities. And so, as harsh as John may have sounded, as uncompromising as Greta seems to be, there's actually good news in their words, because the change that they're calling us to make is for the flourishing, not only of our own lives, but those of future generations, for everyone on the planet. So I think, like everybody else, I want to cherish love when it's tender and warm and kind and gentle. But the story of John the Baptist and the example of people like Greta Thunberg say that sometimes love can be beautiful when it's tough and direct and confrontational. And I saw an example, a powerful example of this, in my family's life some years ago. On one occasion, my mother detected in her body a lump that did not belong where she found it. So she began a series of medical appointments, and we eventually discovered that this lump was malignant. So then finally came the time to meet with a physician where we could begin to discover next steps. How was this going to be addressed? Now, the physician with whom we spoke had actually known my mother for many years, because my mother had been a nurse and they had worked together in the same hospital, so they shared a kind of trust. And during the meeting, As we explored options, finally my mother said, I don't want to talk about this anymore. I'm not going to do anything about this. I'm just going to let nature take its course. And there was a very pregnant pause, and this physician looked at her directly, kindly, but directly, and there was a kind of gentle fierceness in his words. He said, Norma, you know exactly what's going to happen if you do that. Another silence. And my mother looked at him and she said, after a few moments, when can we schedule the surgery? Now, the doctor never used the word repent or repentance, but in a sense he was calling my mother into a metanoia moment. And these are moments that we have in our lives, all of us. And they can be from the minor scale to the major. But that challenge issued by that physician saved my mother's life. And the successful surgery afterwards freed her to enjoy many more happy years on this planet. So thank God for those who come into our lives with voices of change and challenge, inconvenient though they may be. Love speaks in many ways, and when we gather in our sanctuaries to listen to these words of love, let's be open to all of them, those that are warm and tender and those that are fierce and confrontational. We are wise not to dismiss harsh voices calling us to change, calling us to embrace new tasks and make sacrifices, even when we'd rather let things slide. And should there be times when you or I need to speak with a special force that feels outside our comfort zone, may we not hesitate to do so. We can speak the truth in love, but for God's sake and the sake of the world, let's speak the truth that needs to be spoken. 2,000 years ago, a fierce love was born in the backcountry of Judea, not far from the great city of Jerusalem, expressed through a man known to us only as John the Baptist, a man with rough words, rough diet, rough clothing, but a man still at the heart of love. And that love that poured through him and eventually through Jesus, and which has continued to find expression in the world through his followers over the centuries, is alive and it's at large today. Working for us, working with us, and always wanting to work through us. Amen.
Oh.
Let us pray. Gracious and generous God, you lavish life upon us in so many different ways, and we are grateful for your abundant compassion. We bring to you this day the prayers we always bring to you, for wisdom to make good decisions, for peace on earth and goodwill among all people, for the resilience to meet the challenges before us, for constancy of love as we care for those around us, and for a spirit of humor and hope to brighten our days. We pray especially for all those across the world who live under the threat of violence or famine, for the people of Ukraine and the people of Afghanistan, for all those across the world who have been displaced from their homes and are in search of shelter and safety. We give thanks for all those aid agencies that work most closely with those in need, and we pray that you will give them all the strength they require to carry out their ministries of mercy. O God of grace and truth, as we strive to practice what we preach, help us also to preach what we practice. Empower us to speak up and speak out when the rights and dignity of any are denied. Save us from weak resignation and fill us with the courage to declare to the world in public what matters most to us in our personal lives and faith. May the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts truly be acceptable in your sight. We pray, O God, for your church across the world. In these times of great transition, help us to find opportunities for discovering your hopes and putting them into action. Help us to be open receivers of your abundant grace and wisdom so that we might live full and generous lives. Strengthen us for the living of these days and the multiplication of your compassion through our words and actions. Still speaking, God, we give you thanks for your presence and accompaniment whenever we rise up to change those things that contradict your love. As we seek to foster a life of faith, we do so with the assurance of your guidance and the promise of your love. And when we live out our faith in the shadow of the cross, give us humility, tenacity, and grace to remain faithful to the callings to which you call us. In Jesus' name, amen. And let us pray together in the words of the Round Hill Community Church Prayer. Our Heavenly Father, shed forth thy blessed Spirit upon all our lives. Make each one of us an instrument in thy hands for good. Purify our hearts, strengthen our minds and bodies, fill us with Christian love. Let no pride, no self-conceit, no rivalry, no ill will ever spring up among us. Make us earnest and true, wise and prudent, giving no just cause for offense. And may thy holy peace rest upon us this day and every day throughout the coming week, sweetening our trials, cheering us in our work, and keeping us faithful to the end. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Go forth in peace. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you. And may the Lord bless you and keep you, make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you, lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace now and evermore.